This is for the second time, and as you know, there are many physical, psychosocial, and spiritual problems involved in COVID patients as well as for their caregivers. So we will be focusing mainly on palliative care aspect of COVID care. So today we will talk mainly about what is the relevance of palliative care in COVID and what can be done or what should be done in patients or caregivers who has grief. So this session will be handled by Rajobal sir, and as you know, he is the chairman of Pallium India, and he is a very well-known palliative care figure in India as well as abroad. So it's welcome, sir. It's over to you.
Thank you, Sunil. Thank you very much. Hello, everybody. Sunil introduced me, but my colleagues have not been introduced here. Sunil is the additional director of our Institute of Trivandrum, and Rajalakshmi, who introduced the whole thing to us, is our coordinator of the ECHO programs. I am glad we are having this session. I know many of you, but there are several whom I do not know. Essentially, this session is aimed, this series is aimed at doctors who will be treating COVID patients. Now, as time goes on, it'll be, I expect, mainly doctors actually manning COVID centers, isolation wards, etc., who will be attending it. Right now, I know majority of people in this group are palliative care doctors. There are exceptions. But if you think in another way, any healthcare provider in India or in the world can be a COVID treating doctor. You never know whether anybody whom you meet, any patient, could be harboring the disease. So this is relevant to all of us, and we might as well be prepared. I understand that we are having this session till 4:15. I will make this initial presentation, and then we will have interaction. We will have enough time for that, and I would suggest that if you are finding that question, you are not getting a chance to speak, by all means send the questions as a chat session. We will bring up the questions as much as possible. Any question that cannot be answered within that time, we will send a response for all the chat questions to everybody. With that, I begin my presentation while Raju is sharing the screen. I'll be just introducing the subject. As far as I can see from the names, every single person here in the group is closely associated with palliative care. There are maybe a couple of names that are not familiar to me. Roger, can you unmute yourself and introduce yourself? റോജറിന് അൺമ്യൂട്ട് ചെയ്യാൻ നോക്കുക നമുക്ക് ഇവിടെ നിന്ന്.
ഹലോ,
പ്ലീസ് ഇൻട്രൊഡ്യൂസ് യുവർ യുവർ ഓഡിബിൾ. Oh, you are muted again.
Hello, sir.
Yes.
I am from Manipur, sir. I was trained in IPM, Institute of Palliative Medicine. I'm a medical social worker.
Okay, very good. Welcome, yes, Roger.
Yes, sir, thank you. Nice to meet you.
Satendra?
Yeah, hello everyone. I am Dr. Satendra Singh from University College of Medical Sciences in Delhi. So by profession, I'm a physiologist, but in addition to that, I'm also a health professional with lived experience of disability. So in that way, I have experienced suffering, I know about disability, and I have a special interest in disability vis-a-vis palliative care.
Thank you, not only for the introduction, but also for the brilliant work that you have been doing in the field of disabilities. Thank you for all that you have done for all of us. Thank you, Satendra. Dr. Dekha. Sorry, we don't know the pronunciation, Dr. Dekha. Dekha.
Hello. Hello.
Yes.
Can you hear me, sir?
Yes.
Hello, sir.
Yes, we can hear myself, you.
Myself, Dr. Arun Dekha. Hello.
Yes, go on.
Myself, Dr. Arun Dekha, I'm calling. I am basically a pain specialist at Guwahati. I have a special interest on palliative. I am running a palliative care center here at Guwahati State Cancer Institute.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for joining with you.
Very glad you are here.
Dr. Mary Abraham.
Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am, we can hear you.
I'm Mary Abraham. I'm a pain and palliative care doctor working in Delhi in Max Institute of Cancer Care and Max Panchil Hospital. And I've also been associated with Pallium in a very close way. So it's very nice to be part of this.
Thank you,
ma'am. Dr. Rajan Negi. Dr. Rajan.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon.
I am an NFPM fellowship. I'm doing an NFPM fellowship from Kozhikode IPM.
Welcome to the group. Where do you work?
I work in Himachal Pradesh, Mandi Medical
College. Oh, Mandi. Okay. Welcome,
sir. Dr. Raju. Sir, we can't hear
you. You are not audible. Speak up. Dr. Raju, you are not very much audible, so I will do the introduction. Dr. Raju is the founder of AIDS Care Foundation, a non-government organization based in Visakhapatnam. We have worked closely together for many years. He is a palliative care physician. Thank you, Raju. Next.
Dr. Haseena. Dr. Anchika.
Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Dr. Anchika. I'm working in Cancer Research Institute, Dehradun, Uttarakhand. I'm a surgical oncologist and also a trained palliative care physician.
And Anchika has made her hospital a pain-free hospital, where every single patient is asked, do you have pain? And the pain is effectively treated. Proud to have you with us, Anshika.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Dr. Sangamitra. Dr. Pritesh Patel.
Myself, Dr. Pritesh Patel. I am working as palliative care physician at Guru Gobind Singh Hospital, Jamnagar, Gujarat.
Hi, Pritesh. Good to have you with us. Next.
Dr. Sangamitra.
Yes.
Hello, Sangha.
Yeah, I think you've muted me. Hello.
You are audible, Sangha.
Yeah, okay. Hello, sir. How are you?
Very good.
Yeah. So I'm Dr. Sangamitra. I'm from Assam, Guwahati. And I'm working in Assam Cancer Care Foundation as a palliative care specialist. Good to be in this echo session, which is an important session, I believe. So I'm looking forward to participate. Thank you for getting me through this. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Dr. Haseena?
I'm Dr. Kumari, and I'm working in Dr. Weber Institute as a palliative care physician.
Hi.
Thank you, ma'am.
I'll be joined by Dr. Bhagavati sir, Kabindra Bhagavati sir, who is the medical officer in the Department of Palliative Medicine in B. Barwa Cancer Institute.
Okay, welcome.
Yes. Dr. Sunita?
Hi, I'm Dr. Sunita. I work in General Hospital in palliative care, and I've got Dr. Chitra with me. She works in Believers Medical College. She's currently working, doing a voluntary session at the Ernakulam General Hospital. And we're both members of the Palli COVID Kerala group.
Thank you.
If I may add something, Sunita and Chitra, along with 14 other people, 12 of them from within India and 2 from abroad, have together formed a brilliant informal group as an immediate response to the COVID crisis. They called it Palli COVID Kerala, and already working on very tight schedule over a 10-day period, I think they created an e-handbook which has just been completed. If you Google for Palli in India, you will find it given there. I strongly recommend that you go to Palli India website, see the handbook, and I am sure it will be a very useful resource for you about management of patients. Yes.
Thank you, ma'am.
Was Sunita going to say something, or Chitra?
No. I just wanted to thank you.
Thank you, Sunita.
Thank you, ma'am. Bhavana? Dr. Rajasree?
Registry, a palliative care doctor, world member, and master members of palliative Kerala. Thank you.
See, there was some sort of echo-like feeling. We couldn't hear you properly. But Rajasree, by the way, is another member and a solid contributor to the Palliative COVID Kerala group and the handbook. Next.
Dr. Indu. Doctor, we can't hear you, ma'am.
Here now?
Yes.
Okay, my name is Dr. Indu. I was trained in Pallium India. I was working there. Since 1 year, I have resigned my job and I'm in Riyadh now, not working currently.
Thank you.
I suspect that some people may have been left out. Is there anybody else who should introduce yourself?
Doctor, can you see your name? Who have logged in from Honor 8?
Yeah. I'm Dr. Preeta.
Okay, ma'am. A brief introduction, ma'am.
Yeah. I'm working as assistant surgeon at CHC Kalara. Assistant surgeon at CHC Kalara.
Okay, Kalara in Kerala. Okay.
Kerala, Trivandrum.
Dr. Rakesh?
Hello?
Yes, doctor, we can hear you.
Hello, is it audible?
Yes.
Yes, it is.
Ah, sir. Sir. It was nice to meet you again, sir. Very manipulative care. I got to know you through Rontu Sama from Meghalaya, sir.
Pleased to meet you, Rakesh.
Sir. Sir, how will the session will go on? Maybe
it'll finish at 4:15, and every day it'll be at the same time, and the last session will be on Saturday. So 6 sessions for 75 minutes each from 3 p.m. to 4:15 p.m.
Sir, thank you, sir. So I'll be there. I will get to watch, sir.
Very good.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Anybody else? Shall we move on? Raju, can you get the first slide on, please? So, from tomorrow, different members of the faculty will be dealing with specific issues, symptom control, and so on. I'll be doing a general introduction today, but also going a little into grief and bereavement, just to make sure that we understand, everybody understands what the implications are of COVID-19. The world in a few months is not going to be the same world that we lived in all these years. There's going to be a new normal, and our role in that new normal is something worth thinking about. I'm talking about this, I'm not sure what the world is going to be next year. I have no idea. I can only make some guesses. I can only guess some of the important elements of suffering in that world, and maybe work together with you to prepare ourselves to face that world. What I'll do is I'll start with where we are in palliative care in the country. What you see on the screen is an evaluation by an international body called the Economist Intelligence Unit, who worked with the Lion Foundation in Singapore to bring out this evaluation of status of palliative care in various parts of the world. In 2015, when they published the last report, 80 countries were included. Unfortunately, India figures among the worst 50. In 2010, when they published that from 40 countries, we were at the very bottom, 40th. But now we are at 67th place, not a happy situation. And that I should generally to indicate that compared to the rest of the world, India is lagging behind in treating suffering. We treat diseases, we have hospitals of international standards giving disease-focused care, but we ignore suffering. Many developing countries, including Uganda and many African countries, are ahead of us in this matter. This is a reality we have to accept. We do not treat suffering. This is how the World Health Organization defines palliative care. Defines health. We all have heard this in community medicine and then forgotten it. Health is physical, mental, and social well-being, and not merely the absence of disease and infirmity. So we know this, but still ordinarily our treatment is too focused on diseases. And today, judging by the global response to COVID-19, we are doing precisely the same thing. All our attention is focused on the virus. Testing, how do we test the community? How do we prevent a community spread? how do we treat COVID once it has occurred? Maybe somebody has breathing difficulty. How do we artificially ventilate him? That's our concentration. But what about the person's quality of life? That's the element that is left unaddressed. It shouldn't be that way. In 2002, the World Health Organization defined palliative care. And I'm not going to give the whole definition, but only one part of it. That is, it's about improving quality of life. In any patient with life-threatening illness and the family, great, but one part of it became a problem. Because the World Health Organization used the word life-threatening, all the concentration was on terminal illness. Because the word life-threatening was used in the context of longevity. So what about the suffering of somebody who lives with something like ALS, or even somebody with a paraplegia? Through their life, what all do they go through? So if we use the word life-threatening like that, we will have to remember that life should not be defined and discussed only in terms of longevity, but should be considered in terms of quality also. Very recently, the Lancet Commission on global access to palliative care and pain relief brought out this phrase. So the world is more or less agreed at the moment that the focus of health palliative care and the focus of healthcare should be on serious health-related suffering. While we are treating diseases, preventing and treating diseases, we should also be addressing serious health-related suffering. And now coming to the COVID-19 situation, this is a focus that the healthcare systems around the world do not seem to remember much and which we should be concentrating on. The whole program that PAVI-COVID Kerala is worked on and this educational program on which PAVI-COVID Kerala is associating with PAVI India, it's focused on this one issue of serious health-related suffering. Now, the concept of integrating palliative care into healthcare as a whole is not very new. It is 6 years since the World Health Assembly is the decision-making body of World Health Organization. The 6 years since they asked all national governments around the world to integrate palliative care into all healthcare at primary, secondary, and tertiary levels of care across the continuum of care from the beginning of the health-related suffering to the end, to anybody new to palliative care in this group, I don't think there's anybody. In case there is, remember, when does palliative care begin? It should begin as soon as health-related suffering starts, which can be before the diagnosis even. At that time, the suffering should ideally be treated. This should be our objective. Now, when we consider this health-related suffering, what we see in the textbooks may not be the reality in our country. So as we today talk about COVID-related suffering, this is something that we'll apply our minds to. What exactly is the suffering of the average Indian? Now, the average Indian is not you or I. Everybody who has access to this system and is checking the And as Zoom is not an average Indian, the average Indian is out there suffering. These four are traditionally what we talked about. Physical suffering. In the case of COVID-19, the commonest major elements of suffering are cough and breathlessness and delirium and agitation. They are the commonest. There are others. And remember what we said earlier. We are also talking about the suffering of the family. The social suffering for the family after the lockdown is well imaginable. More than half our population, one third of our population was always poor, dependent on their daily earning for livelihood. And in the last 2 weeks, what would have happened to them is unthinkable as far as their suffering is concerned. What would have happened to relationships? People getting locked up, men deprived of alcohol, how much of physical violence is happening within families? These are all realities, and the relationship issues and the poverty are the background on which a COVID-19 comes in, when they have no resources left, when there are other issues. And the emotional issues. The depression, anxiety, the usual thing, every palliative care person knows about it. But here, there is this psychosocial added issue of isolation. People with COVID-19 are isolated. They are there alone. And if they are in advanced disease, if there is no comeback, they don't see their loved ones once more. And their loved ones do not see the person once more. They do not even see the dead body. You know what we always teach? Even if it's a stillborn child, the mother is given an opportunity to hold the child. It is so necessary for the grief and bereavement. But here, that is also being deprived. And the spiritual issues, I don't only mean the religious issues. A man, an intense Catholic, now being deprived of the last communion, what would his emotions be? What would the family's feelings be? But it's not only that, like the feeling of being totally rejected, totally alone, all these are elements of suffering. There are not many things that we can do about many of them, but there are always some things that we can do about all of them. Those are some of the things that we'll talk about in the next 5 days also. And we'll remember that most of those suffering, elements of suffering are not visible. When what the patient complains to you about is only what is visible, that part of the iceberg that's visible, which is only a small part, 1/10 or 1/9. The breathlessness is very visible. The agitation is visible. But all the other problems they have lived with, the COPD the man has been living with and which is impossible for him to bear, the pain from osteoarthritis or rheumatoid arthritis, the rheumatoid arthritis, all the chloroquine has been consumed by all the doctors in the country who were hoping to prevent COVID. Patients with rheumatoid arthritis do not have it. And the lack of earning and the issues that we talked about already. Why I show this picture is to see that while we may not be able to do a lot about all of them, once we understand that they are part of the problems, at least for some of them, we'll be able to do something. And not only is the person with advanced COVID-19 isolated and deprived of social interaction and has to suffer the physical symptoms also, but in addition, they are submitted to inappropriate artificial life support measures, which add cruel suffering to them. The recovery rate from artificial ventilation in COVID-19 is not very encouraging, particularly for the elderly. Young people may escape, but particularly for the elderly, it's very bad. I will not try to quote the figures there because the figures that we see are changing every day. And maybe the figures for survival of artificial ventilation are better than we thought they were. Having said all that, in an elderly person with multiple comorbidities, even without COVID-19, the outcome was never very good. For a person above 80, the chance of somebody getting back to reasonable quality of life after a prolonged artificial ventilation was never good. And particularly with COVID-19, it's atrocious. So I know what I would want, at least now I think I know. If I am having COVID-19 at my age, I would rather receive palliative care from one of you rather than a tube down my throat and artificial ventilation, because with great difficulty you may pull me through. I also will have to know the live with the feeling that I have blocked that ventilator, which would have saved 7 young people's lives. But at the end of it, I am unlikely to be have any enjoyable quality of life. Which is why I personally have created an advanced directive. I have added COVID-19 into this, asking that if I have breathing difficulty with COVID-19, I should not be ventilated. That's a personal choice of mine. It may not be everybody's choice, but today nobody is given a choice. Even today, all the government discussions are about creating more ventilators to ventilate everyone who has breathing difficulty. The handbook that Chitra, Sunita and others together have created talks about triage, talks about how we will examine patients and make some recommendations about the proper treatment to follow, when it will be useful and when it will not be useful, when it can better be palliative care and so on. Now, with that introduction about palliative care, in the COVID situation, because this group has been mostly palliative care people, I've not gone into the details about palliative care. I only talked about its relevance to palliative care. But the rest of the time that I have now, I think I will deal more with grief and bereavement. This is not something that is talked about nationally, but this is something that we are going to see. We don't see them because the bereaved people are all under lockdown. They are not visible. Bereavement is the situation where somebody has lost a loved one. Somebody with whom you have a connection. A friend dies, you are still bereaved. And grief is the reaction to that bereavement. The psychological, social, emotional, spiritual and cognitive responses to that bereavement. When you lose something, you grieve. That grief is your natural reaction. It is necessary. It is necessary for you to go through the grieving process so that you can get over it. Get over it, not completely. The grief will never disappear completely. It will always be there if the person who has been lost is attached to you very much. But you get back to life, somehow get back to living a near normal life. That grief And as I said, grief is normal. Grief is something that you have to live through. Some of the loss is anticipatory. If I get a diagnosis of a serious illness, whether it be cancer or COVID, my grief starts now. It starts now for what I am losing today, but it's also for what I am going to lose tomorrow. The thought that I'll never see my children again, I wish I had spent more time with them when I could, all that comes out at this day. The degree of nature of changes of grief change from person to person. We very often talk about empathy in palliative care, thinking from another person's role, trying to put yourself in somebody else's shoes, trying to understand the suffering. But that empathy is good, so long as you and I understand that the process cannot ever be complete. I can never ever fully understand what that person is going through because that person is not me. So this I must be able to understand, and we should resist the temptation of saying ever again, look at me. I have gone through losses. I am sitting before you and functional. That is not a right attitude at all. We have to understand that everybody has a right to be himself or herself. An American psychiatrist, Dr. Elizabeth Kubler-Ross, who came to be known as the death and dying lady because of all the work that she put in about the suffering and the dying. Nobody ever had studied it as a science. And the world went on dishing out disease-related treatment without understanding grief. This list, as Kubler-Ross herself accepted, is not a complete list. But this is the list that she said thought was commonest in that order. Denial. No, this cannot be true. How can I have COVID? I don't have comorbidities. I am otherwise healthy. Anger. What do you mean you brought this to me? When you visited me last week, you must have brought it. Why did you come over when you knew that you had been traveling earlier? The anger is against COVID and God or fate, but it is manifested whoever is available in front of you to show it to. And because we are doctors or nurses, we can, or social workers, we may be the ones available to them, and the anger may break out against us. Bargaining can be with God, I'll reform, I'll live a good life hereafter, I'll always pray to you so many times a day. All these thoughts may come in, all these feelings and the expressions may come in, but bargaining can also be take the form of doctor shopping or system hoping. Sunil is now treating a person who has intense suffering, who possibly had a curable illness, who chose not to have a curative treatment, and went on pursuing alternative systems of medicine for 2 years, and now she's having a horrible time. This bargaining is very common, and we are going to see all this in our patients who do not report their symptoms, allow the COVID-19 to worsen while they pursue miracle cures here and there. Depression. As we said, grief is natural. But a clinical depression, where the person loses control over oneself, when the depression becomes a disease entity with physical manifestations also, like abnormal sleep patterns, altered appetite, constipation, and so on, that is also a possibility. And as Kubler-Ross pointed out, the healthier state may be acceptance. When somebody accepts, yes, this has happened. Okay, I've had COVID. I should be looking at how I can get better. I should certainly be protecting my family. So what am I going to do? And that is the healthier stage. Even in somebody who is dying, those who are in acceptance generally are more at peace with themselves. There are many others that will be particularly associated with COVID, particularly guilt. Oh my God, because I went on working during these days, I have endangered my family. And that kind of guilt, which may be reinforced by a random comment. Oh, but why did you do that? Why didn't you isolate yourself as soon as you started having that cold? And those questions can reinforce that guilt. So by no means is this list complete. And everybody doesn't go through it in this order. Those who have read that Paul Kalanithi book, When Breath Becomes Air, I would recommend that everybody should read it. Paul Kalanithi says he went through all of them in reverse order. Doctor himself just completed his registrarship at the age of around 40, just became a consultant neurosurgeon, and he gets a diagnosis of cancer. And he says he was in acceptance. Then came the depression, and he went through everything in a reverse order. All this we may see in our patients. But remember, we are not only talking about the patients, the families too. I know right at the moment we are not able to do much for the families, but this should be foremost in our minds. When we can, a busy doctor treating COVID may not have the time, but when we can, we should be thinking about the families. As I said, grief may occur before the loss, when you know that you may lose something, a person, your own life. Anticipatory grief, you cannot say that, okay, just hope for the best. That's not the answer. The answer lies in listening and find out what fears are reasonable, what are unrealistic fears. Removing the unrealistic fears itself reduces a good part of the grief. And following loss of a loved one. There is grief over what has been lost. My God, he has been so much a part of my life. How will I live without him? Or how can I can't even stay in this house. This house is empty. It's like a ghost house. That's the grief over what has been lost. But there is also something that will creep in. That's restoration grief. The person who has lost his spouse and is grieving over that on the sixth day finds that somebody is coming over and gently reminding, look, I know this is a horrible time. Sorry to have to bring it up, but I am in great financial difficulties. You know that he had borrowed 2 lakhs from me. I must have the money back. These are realities of life. Restoration grief can be tremendous. That can happen to the man who has lost his wife and finds that he has to make breakfast for himself and his children. has never worked in the kitchen ever. And for the woman who always depended on the man to get things done in the bank or in government offices, these people need a lot of help. And restoration grief worsens the loss, grief of loss, and vice versa. As I said, grief will always be there when we have lost something. Even when you have misplaced your mobile phone and lost it, you are still grieving. If it is a significant loss, a bit more than your mobile phone, it's never forgotten. But most of us gradually move towards an acceptance and a near normal life, usually in 6 to 9 months. That is a just statistic. It may take much longer, it may be much quicker, but we have to understand that the grief will continue through life if it is a significant loss. People who have lost a loved one will tell you that the worst day in their life is the birthday of the person whom he has lost, or the death anniversary very often. Unfortunately, in something like COVID-19, grief is likely to become complicated because there is no time to get used to the isolation. The person has been taken away from you all of a sudden. Started as cough and cold this morning, by evening he's isolated. And you never see the person again. You don't even see the dead body. And that is bound to cause a lot of complicated grief. This will manifest as maladaptive behavior. In your patient downstairs, I was really worried about the younger child who already had behavioral disturbance during the last hospitalization. And now, not seeing the mother for 3 weeks, possibly never seeing her again, that can be tremendously traumatizing. Maybe at least we have one psychiatrist in the group, Chitra, and maybe there will be more of discussion about this. Now, I said earlier that grief is never completely gone in a serious loss, but you get back to near normal life. In a complicated life, grief, you do not. Your relationships, your whole life, your job, your profession, everything is compromised. Here are some usually mentioned. This, I did not take it to any list for COVID. This is generally for pathological grief. Sudden or traumatic death. That does happen to COVID. The same goes for suicides. Multiple loss. Especially when 2 or 3 family members, that's very likely to happen, remember. If there has been one person with COVID in the family, others are likely to be infected. And whoever is surviving will have to live with this series of losses. Whatever social support is possible would be helpful. No doubt about it. It will be very helpful. The complicated grief going on to a long period of time is called chronic grief. Ever no satisfactory conclusion ever, often with delayed social and emotional reactions. And people putting on a brave front, never displaying the emotions, are particularly vulnerable. They have no chance of expressing their emotions, no way of compromising, just getting used to it. And mass grief is indeed a major issue. So also, exaggerated grief, maybe one way of complicated grief that we talked about. So, I'll just mention that is stigmatized grief. I don't have a slide on it, but if a wife or husband loses a spouse, yes, they have a right to grieve. Suppose it's a divorced person and a former husband or wife has gone. They have lived together for such a long time, they will may still have intense grief. But you appear sad and somebody says, hey, what are you grieving about? You decided to live without him for such a long time. This is also the case with people with a lot of responsibilities. And all the relatives come and say, hey, you are looking terrible. Don't be like this. You have the responsibility for the 4 children. You cannot afford to behave like this. Get up and get going. That person also has disenfranchised grief. The society does not give them a right to grieve. That also leads to problems. So these are some things which we may not get time to talk about in the ensuing days. But is it our duty to do all this when we are faced with a COVID scare? That is what I close with. Whether it's a question of whether we should be ventilating somebody or whether we should have a provision for supporting families also, which I think is quite doable with enough social support. We will have to remember that COVID-19 can often be an end-of-life situation. Not necessarily, I know, but often. And therefore, we need to be sure what our duty of care is. When I say we, I don't mean the palliative care people. You have taken it as your duty. But any doctor, any nurse, any medical social worker, any healthcare provider needs to remember this. There, you may not always be able to do the right things. Your ethics committee may say, no, no, you can't do that. You may want to put the person on ventilation even if he is 85, because the man wants to do it. Or you may decide not to ventilate the 60-year-old man because he doesn't want to. That would be ethically right. But you may not be able to fulfill what you think is right, because of the administrative reasons, because social issues, financial considerations, or legal position may not be favorable to what you want to do. True. But first, let us make sure that we understand what's our duty. What's the right thing to do? That is step one. Without that, going on and discussing the legal situation is pointless. Duty of care of a doctor, I have put in there quality of life, not prolongation of a dying process in the face of futility of treatment. Quality of life of the patient and the family, the grieving family that I have been spending all this time on. Here is Raju. I changed the slide here. Are you sure that, yes. Sorry. Our duty as healthcare providers, as defined very clearly by Indian Council of Medical Research in 2018 in March, is this. The duty of the healthcare provider is to mitigate suffering. It is to cure sometimes, certainly. Cure. Ventilate if necessary, when it's appropriate and save the person's life. If you cannot, certainly relieve the suffering and always comfort the patient. And as they add, there exists no exceptions to this rule. Once we accept this, all discussions about management of COVID would include palliative care as part of it. With that, I will stop this presentation. I see that we have some 20 minutes left for discussion. Thank you very much for listening to me patiently. Over to you, Suren.
Thank you, sir. So, are there any questions or comments on the topic?
Shall I make a suggestion, Suril? Shall we give the first opportunity for the non-palliative care participants in this group, somebody who is not already a palliative care professional, there are two or three only in the group. So any question from any of you who are not actually practicing palliative care? And Satyendra, I know that you are connected to palliative care. In a way, to some area of palliative care, you are certainly involved, but you are not in the mainstream palliative care. That's the kind of situation that I am talking about.
Well, yes, sir. It was indeed a great listening to you and clarifying some of the concepts which was not clear to me, because this is my first foray into palliative care, to be honest. And as a person with a disability and as a physician, I often talk about, think about specifically during medical rationing or the triage decision making, because many a time those decisions are taken by health professionals, which are usually focused on their assumptions, their beliefs, maybe quote unquote their biases about the quality of care of that person. So that person may be an obese person, maybe somebody, because the literature on the quality of care has largely been written by non-disabled researchers. So if you ask me, I have read lots of reports which says that the quality of, you know, life of disabled people is not very good. Unfortunately, if you see the research done by disabled researchers, they disagree with that. And right now, this situation is happening in US in COVID-19, that at least 5 states are there in which there are legislations framed on specifically this issue, that the medical rationing is, you know, they are singling out people with autoimmune disorders, cystic fibrosis, that they will not receive ventilators. So that is something which I was thinking about, because I'm not aware in India whether we have stringent guidelines on triage which are, you know, well accepted or not. So that situation might come in India as well, maybe in coming months, that we have to take these very difficult ethical dilemmas questions. So in that conditions, you know, as palliative care physicians and health professionals, I think it is our duty to first of all admit our own biases about quote unquote quality of life.
Raju, is it possible to share the screen again and bring the last slide back? Last but not slide back. Can we go back on slide, Raju? Sorry for wasting your time. Okay. I hope you can see that picture. I said that the first consideration for me would be my duty to improve the quality of life. But what Satyendra is very rightly pointing out is that I will remember the quality of life, but I will not try to be the judge. If I say the man is quadriplegic, life is not likely to have any quality, that's being defended. Oh my God, quadriplegic people have contributed so much to humankind. They have had the most worthwhile life sometimes. So we shouldn't be, Satyendra's point is we shouldn't be judgmental. Look at the second part under ethics. These are the 4 fundamental principles of medical ethics. It is not me who is to decide who will have quality of life, it is the patient. As I said earlier, if the 85-year-old man with COVID and multiple morbidities says, I am going to get over it, put me on a ventilator, do everything, I have a moral duty to abide by that. Having said that, autonomy is not the only ethical principle. It's an overriding principle, but not the only principle. There may be other considerations. Look at the last one, distributive justice. the medical superintendent or one of our colleagues, Sangamitra, is going to come and ask me, look, his chances are so low. And there is that 10-year-old child with COVID and pneumonia who needs this. That child has an excellent care, chance of care. How do you decide? This is where, in the handbook that they have created, they have put in that triage. There may be a conflict between autonomy and justice, or even with beneficence or non-maleficence. So one recommendation is, an individual doctor, when he looks at the patient's interest, his patient's interest is considered first. But as a society, as an establishment, as a hospital, the hospital's ethics committee may decide, look, this is not right. I know you have a dilemma. I know he's your patient and you feel the responsibility. But this committee decides that the ventilator should go to 10-year-old. Now, these are realities we'll have to face most probably in the next few weeks. And those are things that we'll have to live with. Underline Satendra's point that the doctor or nurses or social worker is not a judge to decide whose quality of life is going to be good or not. We can make assumptions, help the person to take the right decisions by listening to him, giving him the right information, and giving him the mental frame of mind to make intelligent decisions. Thank you, Savendra. Anybody else?
Any questions
or comments?
So I actually have a comment to make. Sir, as in your presentation, you nicely put it that grief and bereavement period is a little different during this COVID situation. So let me share with you a horrifying personal experience our family just faced. So we are living in Uttarakhand. And basic family, first relative family member passed away with a massive MI at home in Punjab. And because of the curfew in Punjab, we could not get permission to travel there. And the last rites and things had to be done by the relatives, whoever were available at that point. Because of the curfew in Punjab, they allow only 4 people to be present during the cremation, and there are multiple other rules and regulations. So just going through that experience, we realized that all these bereavement period and the grief period is very different during this COVID situation for everybody, because you cannot meet up with each other, have all the social norms and customs being followed at that time, which probably take your mind off the relative's mind off of the loss they have suffered, at least for some time. And also the person, the relatives feel that they could not do much for the person who has died and do all the customs and whatever they wanted to do. So that and they also feel guilty that like for our family, we felt very guilty that we could not travel from Uttarakhand to Punjab to be with the family. So those things we have to keep in mind probably, you know, when we see patients and families suffering at this time, whether it is a COVID patient or a regular other disease mortality death.
Thank you, Anshika. Thank you. Absolutely. And what about all those people, Indians dying abroad, some of them dying alone, all the family back in India, and they never even see the body again. And if they are intensely religious, they have to go through the feeling that his soul will never be saved because he has not gone through the rites. Instead of a cremation, a burial was done, or instead of a burial, a cremation was done. Those are very, very painful thoughts for some people. Thank you, Anshika.
Any more questions?
Chitra, would you like to add at a psychiatrist perspective? Chitra is with Sunida.
Dr. Jitin, anything to add to this?
Chat is just a question alone.
Am I audible?
Yes, yes. I do.
Sorry that I'm departing from the issue now, but COVID is also affecting the way we deliver our palliative care services to our existing patients, whether it's home care or OPD or hospice. That's an important topic we have to address. If not part of this, maybe later. It's really frightening because of many of our doctors are 60 plus. I can't see any way how we can ask them to go for
home care. Can you please keep the microphone closer to your... yes.
Sir, COVID is...
Yes, we heard you. But yes. It was rather feeble, yes.
Okay.
So, absolutely. It's already happened. This is not, we are not talking theory. It has already happened. Here we had 1,350 patients on our home visit list. Immediately after the lockdown, there was a period of practical paralysis. We didn't know what to do. We immediately started making phone calls and delivering everybody medicines and supplies for 6 weeks. But that's not enough. They won't be seen in person. And many of them, many didn't want us to go. That also happened. In the early days of COVID, the home visit team who went from here had 8 files on them. 4 of the patients said, don't come. They were afraid that we'll bring them disease. So all sorts of things happened, and many people felt rejected because on the appointed day, home visit didn't happen. Many people were overwhelmed with happiness that despite the lockdown, the visit still happened. So yes, those who are receiving palliative care do get, why Raju, any comorbidity, the hypertensives, the diabetics, laboratories used to go home to people and collect the blood samples. They just stopped doing that. And they didn't have the technology themselves to do it by themselves. They didn't have a glucometer. There was nobody to teach them. So, yes, and elective surgery is not happening. It is certainly a major health crisis there. So Sunita and Chitra are not with us anymore, are they?
Sangamitra? Please unmute yourself.
Sangha, can you unmute yourself?
Yes, now can you hear me?
Yes, yes, a bit louder, Sangha.
Now is it okay?
Yes, very good.
Okay. So I want to share my personal experience that I had gone through within this very short period of time. Our organization has a working relationship with all the medical colleges in Assam. And recently we have started with establishing cancer screening kiosks in all the medical colleges, most of them, till our hospitals are being constructed. So in that endeavor, I have been assigned to work with the superintendents and principals of these medical colleges, especially with the Guwahati Medical College, as I'm based out of Guwahati. So in that process, you know, in the start of this COVID crisis, the principal had requested us to give our kiosks as a screening area for COVID-19. So fortunately or unfortunately, the superintendent had, you know, wanted me to volunteer in the microbiology department of the hospital, and I was a part of a team of the infection control process. So I started, I was given a, you know, four of us were given a duty to start with this process, and I was supervising the infection control in the COVID screening area itself for around 6 to 7 hours per day, every day. Supervising, you know, mainly the doffing and donning of PPEs, and you know, how the control is being made, and reporting to the super and the microbiology head about the whole process. The first patient, the first case that became positive in Guwahati came in my duty itself, and you know, out of the sheer palliative care trait that I have developed inside my genes, you know, I went ahead and I was trying to talk to the wife of that patient who was seemingly sick, you know, crying, and you know, because she was fearful that they might have had contracted the disease, all the family, because they have a travel history. The husband was sick, and then the husband, after seeing that I was talking to the wife, also came forward to have himself ventilated. But then after 2 days, the results of this patient came and he was positive, and I was totally, you know, under the threat that, you know, I am a direct contact of that patient. So I had to notify my authorities. I was asked to, you know, look for symptoms for the next 7 days. Fortunately, nothing happened in these 7 days. But then on the 8th day, you know, I started having fever. And the fever was not too high grade, but then I had again had to notify, because that was a protocol. When I had notified that, I was totally isolated in the isolation ward of the COVID ward. So that was a kind of a nightmare, because my samples were taken, I was isolated, I couldn't, anyway, I had already separated my family, my husband and my son, you know, before starting onto this duty. I had sent them to my father's place, anticipating that such situation might arise. So maybe that was a wise decision that I had taken. After the isolation, till the reports came, it was almost 36 hours that I was inside one small room, going through all those stages that you had very beautifully described. And I was, you know, I perhaps fitted in all the five stages that were described by you. Really, to be very frank, I did not repent why I had gone ahead and talked to the patient, because, you know, I could see the kind of relief that I could give to them by just talking to the wife, even maintaining a fair amount of distance. So that was a kind of a reward that I had got. And, you know, seeing my proximity of, or my eagerness to talk to that patient, also enabled many other people who were there for screening on that particular day. Interestingly, the doctor on duty who was supposed to take the notes, he was he came forward all the time, warning me, ma'am, you are going too far, don't talk to them. And I was really unable to explain to this doctor why I am doing this. Perhaps, that was not the right situation. I was not able to communicate to this doctor because he was too scared. They were all young doctors being placed in the screening area. They had to don the full PPE and then, do their duty with lot of stress. It seemed as if they have been, thrown into a sea of infectious agents where they have to protect as well as do their duty. It seemed that they are there not with dedication, but do their duties. So I think we also need to look for such kind of care. I'm sure we are going to have a self-care workshop on this on the last day, I think Saturday, and that would be a very good thing to do. And I would like to know how is it possible for all of us as palliative physicians to include these young people who are inside the screening area or the COVID ward or the isolation ward, who are doing, because when I was in isolation, I never got to see anybody who would actually come and talk to me. I was totally depressed. I didn't take phone calls for a long time. I knew that, there was always a chance of getting a positive result and then being, taken away from my family, throwing me inside an isolation ward where I would, where there was always an uncertainty and the fear of the unknown. So all these things have really gripped me very hard. Thankfully, the results have come and I'm negative, tested negative. And when I introspect, I see that, I didn't do a very bad job. If I get a chance, I would again go ahead and do it. Now, of course, I'm quarantined for another 14 days. Within these 14 days also, I'm regretting why quarantined. So I'm trying to start off with a telephone counseling service for all cancer patients. I'm going to post that in Facebook and all other social media and WhatsApp group also, so that patients can, or people who want to talk to me about it, can share their experiences and I can at least guide them through their suffering. That's it, sir. Thank you.
Thank you for sharing that.
So we have exceeded our time. So sorry, if you have any questions, you can send us through email. So today we talked about the suffering of the patients, not only of COVID patients, but any patients who has a serious illness. And the importance of grief in this particular situation. And Sangamitra had a personal story to tell us. So thank you all. Thank you, sir, for being with us today. And thank you all. We will meet same time tomorrow.
With the topic of management of symptoms in COVID-19. So thank you all for joining in. We'll see you tomorrow. I've shared the feedback link. Give it a minute, do it, then only leave the meeting. Thank you all. Thank you.